Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you and also with you. It's great to welcome you to our online worship, whether you've been before to join us in our online worship or whether you're quite new to this, we're delighted to welcome you here. This service that you're going to take part in is exactly the same as the service that is being held today in the churches of St Mary's Riddlesden and St Luke's East Morton. They will have the same songs, the same sermon, the same liturgy. The only difference is that the liturgy and the sermon will be spoken live in the church buildings, and everything else will be recorded as you're watching here. So, as I say, it's great to welcome you today to our worship. Just a couple of notices. Later on this morning, there will be a tonic service uploaded onto our YouTube channel and our Facebook pages. Our curate Gareth is putting that together. This evening, there will be a Zoom fellowship, as usual, at 6 o'clock, and anyone is welcome to join that. If you're not quite sure how to join, do have a word with Gareth or me, and we'll help you come into that Zoom fellowship. There will be Holy Communion on Wednesday next week at St Mary's Church at 10 o'clock, and St Luke's Church will be open on Wednesday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon until 4 o'clock for private prayer. Next Sunday, we're having Holy Communion as our main Sunday service. It'll be the first time that we've tried doing that since the lockdown. You'll be able to watch the same service online as people join in at St Luke's and St Mary's. And after the service at St Luke's next Sunday, the church will be holding its annual parochial church meeting. I don't think there are any further notices to mention, so we'll have a moment of quiet before I lead us in the opening prayer. A moment of quiet. The Apostle Paul tells us that there is nothing in the whole of creation that will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is ours in Christ Jesus. So let us pray with confidence. Faithful God, whose word is life, come with saving power to free our praise, inspire our prayer, and shape our lives for the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first hymn is number 644 in the hymn books. God is love.
Thank you.
come to the prayer of confession. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So let us show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. The first Bible reading comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 29, beginning at verse 15, and tells the story of how Laban tricked Jacob. It's read for us by Alan Robinson.
Laban said to Jacob, "You shouldn't work for me for nothing, just because you are my relative. How much pay do you want?" Laban had two daughters. The elder was named Leah, and the younger Rachel. Leah had lovely eyes, but Rachel was shapely and beautiful. Jacob was in love with Rachel, so he said, "I will work 7 years for you, if you will let me marry Rachel." Laban answered, "I would rather give her to you than to anyone else. Stay here with me." Jacob worked 7 years so that he could have Rachel, and the time seemed like only a few days to him because he loved her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "The time is up. Let me marry your daughter." So Laban gave a wedding feast and invited everyone. But that night, instead of Rachel, he took Leah to Jacob, and Jacob had intercourse with her. Laban gave his slave girl Zilpah to his daughter Leah as her maid. Not until the next morning did Jacob discover that it was Leah. He went to Laban and said, "Why did you do this to me? I worked to get Rachel. Why have you tricked me?" Laban answered, "It is not the custom here to give the younger daughter in marriage before the elder. Wait until the week's marriage celebrations are over, and I will give you Rachel, if you will work for me another 7 years." Jacob agreed, and when the week of marriage celebrations was over, Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as his wife. Laban gave his slave girl Bilhah to his daughter Rachel as her maid. Jacob had intercourse with Rachel also, and he loved her more than Leah. Then he worked for Laban another 7 years. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our next hymn is "Goodness is Stronger Than Evil," number 835 in our books. The words were written by Archbishop Desmond Tutu, and the music is by John Bell.
Goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death. Stronger than you. is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death. Victory is ours. Victory is ours. Through Him who loved us. Victory is ours. Victory is ours. Through Him who loved us.
First reading is from Romans chapter 8. Starting at verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. For we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to His purposes. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, in order that He might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom He predestined, He also called. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will not with Him also give up everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor heights nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We sing now our next hymn, Oh to See the Dawn, the Power of the Cross. It's number 182. In our church hymn books.
The power of the cross.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is so inspirational and life-changing and alive. And we just ask that as we read it and study it this morning, it will get into our hearts and our minds and transform us into being more like you. We ask this in your name. Amen. So Tony, last week while I was away, did section 2 of Romans 8, and he gave it the big build-up that it was better than section 1, and it is the best sequel, even better than Back to the Future, the sequels, which isn't hard, let's be honest. And he's right, it's a really fascinating and brilliant and encouraging part of scripture. But we get to section 3 of Romans 8 now, and rather than it being another sequel, I think I kind of see it as the final performance of a theatre production, and everyone's on stage, everyone's singing, there's dancing, there's going on the orchestra, all the instruments are playing, the chorus is going. And when you're in the theatre, it's just an incredible sight, and you're like, wow, this is incredible. But you miss all the little details because there's so much going on. It's hard to take it all in. That's where we are in Romans 8, this last section. It is a wonderful picture, and hopefully we'll get the overview of it and we'll be like, wow, that is good. And hopefully we'll pick out some of the things, but we just won't be able to do it justice. But I will heartily recommend, as we've studied Romans 8 over the last 3 weeks, really read it. Find a commentary. I can lend you one. Tony can lend you one. It is a wonderful section of the Bible. And I think it's really good to get a good grip of it. For today's section, I think we can put it into four questions, if you like. What God is like when we don't know what to say. What God is like when things are happening in our lives. What God is like when there seems to be no hope. And what God is like when he says he loves us. So that's roughly where we're going to start. Seatbelts on, buckle up, here we go. What is God like when we don't know what to say. At the start of the pandemic, I was hooked on 24-hour news. I was watching it all the time, non-stop, and following it on my phone and stuff like that. And I just found myself like, I don't know what to say about this. So like, it was relentless, and it was so scary and frightening, and I just didn't know what to say about it. And also, when the Black Lives Matter stuff arrives, and we saw George Floyd being knelt on, and all of them protest, and I thought, this is awful. I don't know what to say. And if I got my newspaper today, and if I got the news today, it would be the same thing. I'd be like, oh my goodness. And sometimes I get to that place where I'm like, I don't know what I'm meant to pray. I don't know what I'm meant to say. I'm lost. The Bible in this section, verses 26 and 27, says this: likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but the very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Wow. When we're at that point where we're like, we don't know what to say, it might not just be things going on in the world outside, you know, that could bring us to that point. We might just think, I don't know how to interact with God. The Spirit intercedes for us. Wow. What a wonderful truth to know. And I don't know where you are. I don't know what's going on in your lives at the minute. I don't know what's really on your heart. I don't know what leaves you speechless. But I do know is that as the Spirit dwells in us, we sit, just allow, even in the silence, the Spirit to intercede for us. God will know. What a reassuring truth. Friends, take some time this week to sit and let the Spirit intercede for us. What is God like in our lives as things are going on? And we've got this, I think it's like always in the top five of Bible verses each year when they do what's your favorite Bible verse. This verse from Romans 8, 28 is the verse that is always in the top five somewhere. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. So we know that God is at work. He's at work for his people, the good of his people, in all things, for those who love him, according to his purposes, who were called according to his purposes. Now, when things are going well, this verse is really easy, isn't it? Oh yeah, God is at work, isn't it great? Yeah, look, you can see this, see that. Look, God's doing good things, I'm doing. When things are rubbish, when the hard times come, when that illness hits or that person dies, when you say, oh, God is at work for all things, for his good, you think, what? What? Are you sure? When that person's taken far too young. Or when that person breaks into your house. It's really hard to then get to that truth and go, oh, that's all right, because God's at work for him. And I don't think it quite like that. I don't think that's how Paul is writing it in this letter. I think God sometimes uses awful situations to bring about his will, to bring about good. He turns them and uses them. And we see it in the story of Joseph, don't we? He's sold into slavery by his brothers. They tore his coat and take it back soaked into blood and say to his dad, he's dead. Actually, just cashed in and sold him into slavery. Later on, God uses Joseph to save loads of people. And in a conversation with his brothers, he says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to save many. Wow. And also we see it, I guess, in the best example is in the cross. As Jesus is nailed to a wooden cross, having committed no crime, he's punished like a common criminal. And then he dies and rises again. But at that moment, Peter says, it's both the wickedness of men and God's set purposes and foreknowledge, both at work at once. Wickedness of men, but God using it for the good of the whole world. So yes, I know, friends, that this truth, this hard line, is hard to take sometimes. But it is good to know that God is at work and that can use all situations for his will and his purposes on our lives. Where is God at work today with us? What's he doing? And then when you think, oh, thanks, Paul, for just dropping that bombshell in there. Then we get on to the next section. What is God like when there seems to be no hope? Well, first of all, he says, let's read it. For those whom he foreknew. And there's a bit of a translation thing there, but probably foreloved. That he loved his people. Then it goes on. For those whom he foreknew or foreloved, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Wow. Now, if there's ever a topic, if you're ever in Christian circles and you want to get a debate going and everyone's a fallout, just say, oh, so what do you think about predestination then? Oh, double predestination. Oh, yeah, it gets everyone going. And we don't really have time, like years, or to really go into that, but I'm happy to have a discussion with anyone who wants to chat about it another time. But just to say that I think it's really important to see God at work in salvation. If you, especially in Romans, if you see that he's talking about that it's not something that we earn or do, that it's God working his salvation. God is at work and we are accepting that. That's how we build up, and we're at this point in Romans, so it would be strange for Paul to change his mind in Romans 8. It's consistent with what he's been talking about throughout the book. It is not us at work, but the work of God. God is the author of salvation. And we ought not to think that God can take action only when we graciously allow him to. Oh, come on. All right. Oh, go on then. You may save me now, God. I don't think that's how it works. I think actually this is God at work. He is the author and perfecter of our faith. He is at the beginning and the end of salvation. It is God at work. It's a difficult concept. It's hard to get our heads around. But I definitely think it's taking it away from us and putting it onto God and saying thank you to him is what we need to do. So it's foreknow. He predestined us. Then he called us. Then he justified us. And then he's going to glorify us. Wow. What a wonderful set of words, a wonderful verse or two in scripture to give us real hope. Real hope. And, you know, me and Naomi were talking about this the other day, that when we face all these tough things that are going on and pandemics and stuff like that, I think those people who face that without hope that there's more, that this isn't just it. Now, when I say hope, it's not something that, well, I think it might happen. No. This is assurance. This is Paul going, this is what God has done and will do. Take that in. Own it. Live our lives in the light of that assurance. It is wonderful. Do you live your life with that assurance each day? Living in that hope? And then we get to the final question. What is God like when he says he loves us? Now in this section, Paul starts it off with five questions. Five questions that he's not really expecting an answer to, because they're not like that. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? Who is to condemn? And then, who will separate us from the love of Christ? He's got these questions. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? And then it goes into this section. Will hardship or distress or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Wow. Everything this world has to offer, all the perils that you can think of, nothing. It will not separate us from the love of God. A bit like that when I was a kid growing up, I don't know why, there was all these wallpaper paste adverts. I remember one where they stuck this guy to a board and they dangled him over the boat and all the sharks are biting like that. And it was saying it just, once it stuck, that's it. And I've not seen these adverts for a while. Maybe we don't do wallpapering anymore. Well, I certainly don't. But that's what he's getting at. Once you're stuck, you're stuck. Nothing can separate us. And then he goes into this wonderful final section and it gets really personal. For I am convinced, he says, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in the whole of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Brothers and sisters, that is incredible. It's very credible. It is wonderful news. Nothing. Death? Nah. Things that happen in this world? Nah. Things in the spiritual realms? Nah. Rulers? Powers? Nah. Nothing can separate us from that love that we have through Jesus Christ our Lord. What wonderful words. So we have God interceding through the Spirit when we don't even have the words to say. We have God who is at work, even in the horrible times, somehow he's working out his purposes. We might not understand it, but he is. God who gives us great assurance, who's chosen us, who knew us before all of creation, and then wants to call us and justify us and glorify us. What great assurance. And then we have this final bit, a God who loves us, that we can't be separated from him. Those who are in Christ are completely stuck to him through the cross of Jesus Christ. It's wonderful news. Let it be a wonderful chorus for us all to sing this week, today. Oh, just let these words go around your brain. Let me finish with it, and then I will hand back to Tony. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our next hymn is not in the church hymn books. It's Bless the Lord, O My Soul.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
Special prayer for today, the collect for the seventh Sunday after Trinity. Generous God, you give us gifts and make them grow. Though our faith is small as mustard seed, make it grow to your glory and the flourishing of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we pray for others and for ourselves, and we begin with some prayers of thanksgiving. The Apostle Paul tells us that the Spirit helps us to pray. So let us bring to God our thanksgiving and prayers in the power of his Spirit. The law of the Spirit brings us life in Christ and sets us free from the law of sin and death. Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise. Like all who are led by your Spirit, we are your children. By your Spirit's power, we cry, Abba, Father. Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise. The Spirit confirms that we are your children, fellow heirs with Christ, sharing his suffering now, that we may share his glory. Father in heaven, we give you thanks and praise. So by your Spirit we praise you forever and praise your glory with all the company of heaven, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Loving God, you sent your Son to bring good news to the poor, sight to the blind, freedom to captives, and salvation to your people. Anoint us with your Spirit. Rouse us to work in his name. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to bring help to the poor and freedom to the oppressed. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to tell the world the good news of your healing love. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to those who mourn, to bring joy and gladness instead of grief. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Send us to proclaim that the time is here for you to save your people. Father, by your Spirit, bring in your kingdom. Now we have a moment or two of quiet to bring our own personal prayers to God. God of mercy, you know us and love us and hear our prayer. Keep us in the eternal fellowship of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our final hymn is number 646 in the hymn books. It's one of the great 19th century traditional hymns, God is working his purpose out. But you'll notice as you watch the version of this hymn that we have it sung for us by choir and congregation and orchestra from the Diocese of Lagos in Nigeria. It's a good way to remind us that there are more Anglicans in Nigeria than there are in England. And if you're observant, you'll notice that during this hymn, they're taking up their collection and offering it to God. We don't take up an online collection, but if you would like to make a donation towards the work of our churches, then it would be great to receive that. And it's also a reminder that the needs of the church overseas are even greater than the needs of the church in our own country. Many of them have been devastated because of the coronavirus, and they need all the help that we can offer. So however you're able to do that, maybe you can think while we sing this hymn of ways in which you can contribute to the work of the church around the world or in our own country. Hymn number 646, God is working his purpose out. Jesus draw you to himself. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Well, it's been great to share in worship with you today. Our online worship coming from St. Mary's Church in Riddlesden. Can I encourage you to go and put the kettle on, make yourself a cup of tea or coffee, find a nice biscuit or a piece of cake, and imagine that you're sharing fellowship with God's people at the back of the church. There is still room for more people to come into our socially distanced church buildings, so if you would like to come and are able to, we'd be delighted to see you. But if you're not able to come and join us, and I realise that many of you will be watching from some distance away, it's still great to join in fellowship with you and to share in praising and worshipping God today. So until we're able to see you in person, stay safe and God bless. Amen.